Hi guys, this is GSNLoan.com and I'm here with the review of the Qbot Rainbow 2. So we're dealing here with a very affordable handset that stands out through its dual back camera here with the LED flash in the mix. So this is a glossy handset that only comes with 3G connectivity. It's got a 5-inch diagonal, a front side LED flash for the camera, and it also comes with a bundled transparent case, which you can see right about here. So you can find this product on TomTop.com for $77, which makes it one of the most affordable dual camera phones on the planet. It's available in black, white, gold, or blue. And for those of you wondering, Qbot is a startup from China that does research and development with a 200 people team, so that's impressive. It also sells its products in Europe, South America, Russia, and Saudi Arabia. Now let's put this case on, but before that, let's talk about the design. So as you can see, this is a very glossy phone. It has a plastic back cover, which is quite hard to remove, but in the end, you should be able to remove it. You really have to push open all of these little safety mechanisms, and in the end you can gain access to the slots, two SIM slots and one micro SD card slot and a non-removable battery. As you can see, the backside stains quite easily with prints and with grease, but luckily we have this one. And also the cover also helps because it makes the phone a bit more grippy. Yes, there's a bit of a grip problem here. The phone is slightly slippery and this helps. Now, if you want measurements, it's 7.9 millimeters in thickness, exactly the same as the Galaxy S7, and it weighs 144 grams, which is about 14 grams heavier than the Galaxy S4 and 2 grams actually lighter than the Huawei Nova, for example. It's got a pretty okay button feedback. I'm not only saying that because of the case, it's okay in general, and it's a bit wide for one hand usage, but we made it work. It's got a gently curved back and also a gently curved facade area, and I have to say that the back cover, the back part of the case, was hard to remove at first, but in the end we got used to it. As I said before, it gets dirty very easily. That's one of the issues. So in the end, it's a slippery phone made prominently of plastic, but not bad looking if you look at it closely. Now, if you want to talk about the display, this one is a 5-inch IPS LCD with a 720p resolution, 10-point touch and 1300:1 contrast ratio. We don't have a video player, that's why we had to resort to the gallery to do our playback, and let's see how that turned out. Here we go. So, as you can see, we got very vivid colors, not exactly oversaturated, but just very vivid, okay brightness, wide view angles, and the contrast is, I would say, mediocre, especially in the sunlight. I also have to mention that this is a non-laminated screen. There's a space between the touch part and the actual screen panel. Now, these are the pixels. We got an RGB stripes pixel arrangement, and then we did the lux meter test. The results fluctuated, as you can see, it's not uniform, but in the end, that's the highest result, and I have to say it's quite impressive, especially for the price tag. So, it beats the LG G4 and also the Motorola Moto Z Play and Xperia XA, but scores below the Sony Xperia X Compact and HTC One A9, for example. Okay, now that we saw the brightness, it's time to move on to other things, and by other things, I mean the options that are related to the screen. So let's see what we're dealing with here. Display. We got the usual MiraVision panel of options, which includes picture mode, which can be standard, vivid, or user mode. And if you trigger the user mode, you'll have to tweak the contrast, saturation, brightness, sharpness, color temperature, and dynamic contrast, to name a few. In the end, I would recommend use the standard mode. It's the best one, it's the default one, and no problem with it whatsoever. We also have brightness level to tweak, adaptive brightness, wallpaper, sleep, screensaver, font size, and the device rotation. In the end, the screen was above our expectations and quite solid, I have to say, for the price tag. Now, other specs included here, well, we've got a quad-core MediaTek MT6580A CPU, that's a mouthful, basically quad-core MediaTek older CPU, 1 GB of RAM, which does not feel enough nowadays, and also 16 GB of storage, as well as a micro SD card slot. So there's quite a bit of lag happening, especially after you've had the device activated for a while, and especially if you've been inside an app for a while. The lag appears after a few minutes of usage, and it's also present in games, is basically that delay between the time you perform an action and the time it actually gets done. Also found when opening an app and doing various other actions. So we're playing Riptide GP Renegade, which, as you know, serves as our benchmark game, and it has so for a long while. This is probably the first time I'm playing it on a phone that doesn't even have 2 GB of RAM. It only has one. So let's see how it runs. There's the Mali 400MP GPU here. Not exactly a performer. And the first thing I noticed when I played this game a while ago was that there's a delay between the image and the sound. Not the best frame rate in the world either. But at least you can do some tweaks from the settings of the game and achieve an improved experience. At least I hope so. Okay, so exiting the app with a hint of lag, trying to get rid of the lag. And now let's see how the benchmarks were handled on this affordable device. Okay, we go back and I set benchmarks. So we did the usual battery of tests like Quadrant, Antutu and so forth. And in Quadrant, we surpassed the Asus Pathfone 2, which is a pretty old phone, but scored below the LG AKA, so that's something. Then there's the Antutu test, which should be here somewhere. Here it is. In this one, we beat the Blubu Picasso 4G, which we tested recently, and the Orange Dive 71, but scored below the Yuhan's A101S and the Letivy 1S. Now, in 3D Mark, this is the result. Of course, it's underwhelming, but I have to mention that it's almost last, so in the GPU front, it's not a performer. It's about on par with the Sony Xperia E4, if you really want a comparison. But at least, with all this lack of performance, there's one good thing, no overheating, only 34.1 degrees Celsius after running GFX Bench, so no overheating here. Now on the battery front, inside this phone lies a 2350 mAh battery, not removable, and let's see how it did in our HD video playback in a loop test. Okay, so we achieved 5 hours and 16 minutes of continuous HD video playback, which is quite low. It's actually the 10th placed phone from the bottom to the top, so if we tested 200 phones, this would be the 190th phone. At least it beats the LG G3 somehow and the Yuhan's A101S, but scores below the Letivy 1S and the Nubia Z11 Mini. Now in the PC Mark test, it fared a bit better actually. Quite surprising for its price tag, 6 hours and 28 minutes, which is acceptable. It's above the OnePlus 2 and the Huawei P10 Plus, that's a shocker, and below the Huawei G8 and the Asus Zenfone Selfie. Now the charging is a bit on the long side, a full charge requires 3 hours and 3 minutes, and after 5 minutes of charging you'll get to 3%, 15 minutes 10%, 30 minutes 23%, 1 hour 49%. Now when it comes to the power saving features, don't worry, we've got them here. Okay, so here we go. Battery. There's standby intelligent power saving. There's battery saver and battery optimization. They have to do with the background applications, with the transfers, location services, and so forth. Now it's time for the acoustics. So we're using the music player, simply called Music. And in spite of the fact we seem to have two grills here, only the left one actually covers the speaker and is very easy to cover by mistake while watching a video or playing a game. As you can see, I'm covering it up with my hand. Now let's actually listen to some tunes and see how the phone performs, but before that, let's have a gander at the sound effects. They're the stock ones. So this is the stock equalizer with genre settings, 5 custom channels, bass boost, surround sound and preset reverb. And if we press play, here we go. Easy to cover up. Some conclusions. Well, the volume is quite high here, it's a loud volume. The sound is pretty clear. I would say we have an okay-ish bass, there's no distortion, and the back does not vibrate, and the guitar is pretty well rendered. We do not have bundled headphones, but we do have a decibel meter and we're not afraid to use it. We put it to good use and let's check this out. So our typical audio sample brought the phone as high as 86 decibels, and when we played the game Riptide GP Renegade, we got up to 96.8 decibels. So the first value scored below the BlackBerry Passport and above the Galaxy S6 Edge, while the second value beats the Galaxy S8, which is no small feat. Now, if you're done with that, we can also go check out other things. So, other things meaning the sound options. So we've got here sound enhancement of the BES kind, BES audio enhance for earphone, speaker and surround. That's it in a nutshell. Now it's time to analyze the camera. So we got a front side 5 megapixel camera with its own LED flash, and at the back there's a 13 megapixel shooter plus a 2 megapixel shooter. So dual camera at the back here, big one and a small one, plus a LED flash. F2.0 aperture, 5P lens plus 2P lens, and that's the back side. Now if you want to start the camera app, let's perform some cleaning. And then I would say medium speed, not the best in the world, but also not a slug. So focus is a bit on the slow side, and picture taking is actually very slow. The zoom is taken in steps and takes a while to get started. And the options of the camera are also quite typical. So we've got HDR here, we got panorama, we got the normal mode, and we got this special mode. It's called blur, and it's basically your bokeh, so you can focus on an element and either blur the background behind it to highlight it, or blur the foreground to highlight it. So your choice, blur foreground or background. Using this option is not your regular bokeh. I will tell you later why. And these are the other options like exposure, color effect, scene mode, white balance, anti-flicker, zero shutter delay, self-timer, picture size and ISO, and you can film up to full HD. So that's it in a nutshell. Let's see the gallery of shots taken with this phone. So gallery here, over 120 shots. So as I said before, the handset is capable of bokeh shots, which means you can play with the focus all you want, but only before taking the shot, not after it, unlike some other phones. So we focused on the duck, we focused on the bear, we alternated between them, and when we wanted to focus on the duck more, we blurred the bear, as you can see here. But the blur isn't total, so his paw got out of the blur, is not exactly a well done blur. And now we blur the duck to highlight the bear. That's what bokeh is about. But once again, not exactly perfect compared to what we've seen on other phones. Surprisingly, the daytime shots were actually quite good. So it was a sunny day at the end of April and we had a pretty okay clarity. Some burn was present here and there, but the HDR tends to solve it. Acceptable details, not bad close-ups, and also not bad focus play, courtesy of the dual cameras and their focus. Good texture of the object we photographed, and here you can see it's an approximate bokeh because what's behind this acorn is not very blurred. Okay, so I like the texture of this peacock, pretty well caught by the camera. If you start to zoom in, you will lose details and see that the picture is quite burned. And in general, I was happy with the clarity and the quality of the pictures and the colors. What I wasn't happy with were the selfies. So the selfies were a bit underwhelming. I'm talking about skin texture, color, and the background. They're a bit grainy and blurry, and the skin feels like it's covered with a grain of sand, which is a bit annoying. The best attribute of the phone, aside from the whole close-up and bokeh thing, is probably the fact it takes some pretty nice close-ups. I have to say that, quite nice close-ups, and the colors are quite realistic. A nice texture of this fountain, quite well done. And as I said before, pretty impressive close-ups, Facebook worthy. Now the panorama was rather modest on this phone, only 3488 over 480 pixels. And in the end, I would say that the camera is not bad at all. It's actually surprising. The drawbacks are the selfies and the bokeh and the slight blur that is not exactly perfectly applied. But I was happy with the lighting, exposure, focus and the colors. It can easily fight the latest phones we've tested, the Nubia ones and the Blubu one. Well, not exactly the Nubia ones, those are mid-rangers, but it can fight the Blubu Picasso with ease. That's daytime capture. So let's see how it handles the low light. Of course, it's a sub $100 phone. What do you expect? It's not exactly a champ at night. We got big streetlight halos, some grain, some blur, huge lights that are overblown. The flash makes everything feel a bit red, and the zoom in drops details a lot. There's lots of grain, yellowish hues, not good detail, and these huge halos make everything worse. So not exactly a phone to take pictures during the night, but during the day it's reasonable. That's something you have to remember. Now, as far as the videos are concerned, we shot in 3GPP full HD, 32 frames per second for some reason, and 23 mega per second. So let's start with the daytime videos. See where they are. We got the peacock here, looking mighty colorful. Okay, so we also have a pretty good microphone here, although when it meets with the wind, not that good anymore. As you can see, the image is quite burnt. You can see that better on YouTube. It's also a bit grainy. If you zoom in, it will zoom in steps and it will take a while. The best thing about the camera is that it's not very shaky, so that's nice. The colors are, I would say, good. When the sun is strong, you'll get some burn, but when the sun is not strong, you'll get some pretty accurate colors. Not bad microphone, nice colors, and not bad exposure change either. After a bunch of good clips, we took a last one which was seriously over sharpened and we were not happy with it, but in general, on average, the camera is quite okay in this area. It's, I would say, tolerable, that's the word, at least not shaky, and delivers a solid acoustic capture. During the nighttime, things get a bit spoiled. It's 18 frames per second and 8 mega per second, but it's a 720p video, keep that in mind, not full HD. So it's blurry, some wind problems with the microphone, when you zoom in there's detail loss, and very shaky when walking. We got violet hues, yellow hues, fog, so you can forget about nighttime capture, although object tracking is, let's say, decent. Okay, and another video, also shot at night, should be here somewhere. Not very accurate, a bit shaky, so forget about nighttime capture, you're better off during the day. Now it's time to analyze other aspects of the phone, like for example the web browser, and you're going to either use browser or Chrome. Let's go with the pre-installed one. Apparently decided to look me up, although the previous time I used it, it did not have any problem with me. Okay, so let's load up gsndom.com. As you can see, I'm using the stock virtual keyboard, which is quite comfy. And I would say that the speed of the browser is reasonable. Doesn't set any records, but it's also not bad either. You can use Chrome if you don't like it. The browser results, like Velamo and SunSpider, were quite modest. I'm talking about Chrome here. Now, on the connectivity front, we get two micro SIM card slots, dual SIM, dual standby, Bluetooth 4.0. There's a USB port at the top, believe it or not, micro USB with USB OTG support. There's hot knot, there's GPS, and it only goes up to 3G. There's no 4G here, Wi-Fi BGN and micro USB, and that's about it. And here you have more details about the connectivity. No NFC, in case you were wondering. This is a stock dialer, and I have to say that the calls were not exactly loud, but the clarity was quite decent. Now, we also did some transfers and monitored them, and this is what came out. So when we play with the Wi-Fi, we got up to 49 mega per second in download and 25 mega per second upload, and when we play with the 3G, 3.5 mega per second download and 4.1 upload. I would say it's within limits and between the regular average of a phone. Okay, so now it's time to discuss the OS. So one of the best things about this phone is that it runs Android 7.0 Nougat, and it also doesn't modify it too much, so it's basically a stock experience. We got the multitasking that includes a carousel, we got a drop down section with notifications and quick settings, and in spite of the lag, in general the experience was quite okay. These are the widgets, also stock, so everything stock and nice here, nothing to object. One of the objections still is the fact that we do not have a fingerprint scanner. It might have been useful, but it was sacrificed for the sake of the price. Now if you go into the settings, we got your usual connectivity options, display, notifications, sound, and some gestures here. We got gesture from the fingers, two finger change wallpaper, three finger screenshot, smart motion, these ones here which are familiar from other phones, and gesture wake, double click, down, up, and a variety of symbols. Apps, storage, battery, users, there's something called DuraSpeed here which boosts the application and the functioning of the phone. There's something called breathing light which can be set to on or off, and location, security, accounts, Google, and printing. So that's about it. Now when it comes to pre-installed applications, we got them here, and the count is quite low, somewhere between 20 and 30 apps, and most of them stock, so no bloatware here. You can only find basically Google apps and a bunch of others, nothing special as you can see. So we got Drive, we got Gallery, we got Gmail, we got your Maps application, we got Photos, Play Games and Play Music, Play Store, and this wireless updater, which serves to update your phone, and it's always nice to have. So that's it in a nutshell. This is the Qbot Rainbow 2, the most affordable phone with a dual camera on the back if ever tested. Now it's time for the verdict. So on the pro side, the camera was a bit above my expectations during the day, and the continuous usage isn't bad. I'm talking about the PC Mark result. Also, the volume is quite high. The handset is not that bad looking. The brightness was actually excellent for this price tag, and it also came with the bundle case that increases its grip. So it also has a front flash for the camera, and it runs Android Nougat. Those are the pluses. Now on the con side, it's pretty slippery. I have to mention that. The bokeh effect doesn't exactly play out as you'd imagine it. The selfies are a bit underwhelming. It takes long to charge up the battery. It's made prominently of plastic. The back cover is hard to remove. These are basically first world problems because the phone itself doesn't have many drawbacks. The main one being the fact that sometimes it has some lag, and clearly it's not a gaming phone. Other than that, for $77 on TomTop.com, I would say you're making a good deal, especially if you want to take good close-ups, some pretty okay bokeh shots if you ignore the definition of bokeh, and if you intend to do some socializing, web browsing and YouTube, and especially the continuous usage was quite okay. Also, very bright screen. This has been the Qbot Rainbow 2. Here, detail at gsndom.com. You can find it on TomTop. Bye-bye.